Hello. I'm so glad you're all here. I thought you'd want to be. Find out what on earth they're going to get up to in that royal kitchen. Let's find out. Pots and pans, measuring jugs and scales fill the floor alongside bags of flour and sugar. So, what is it we're going to be doing? Inquired Thimble, not actually being able to see any sort of a plan taking shape at all.
A marvellous, miraculous, majestic, magnificent cake, Thimble, said Myrtle.
Oh, a cake, said a rather deflated Thimble. She had been so full of hope when Prunus and Myrtle had first said they'd help. Now she thought that maybe they were just being kind and didn't really have much of a plan at all. Prunus looked at Thimble.
Trust us, little fairy. The way to the Queen's heart is definitely through a big, sweet cake.
And Thimble realised that this was the best plan that she had, not to mention the only one. It was a long morning of measuring ingredients and pouring cake mixture into cake moulds and then baking them all. And if nothing else, it was sure to be a very magnificent cake. Thimble convinced herself that perhaps it was not such a bad idea to present the Queen with a gift. And hopefully, it would at least delight the Queen in whatever the outcome be. Prunus had more gardening to do before sundown and so bid farewell to Myrtle and Thimble, promising to be back to inspect the completed cake in all its glory at council. Myrtle pulled a couple of stools together by the fireside.
Now it's just the two of us, little Thimble, she said. Why don't you sit down and tell me all your worries and we'll see if we can ease them a little teaspoon.
Well, said Thimble, all Mother wants is for me to wear dresses, which I hate. And all Father cares about is his reputation. But nobody actually asked me if I wanted to get married, or indeed if I even liked Till, which I do not. And I have worked so hard to be the very best in fairy magic, excelling in all kinds of subjects, that the thought of not being able to explore them makes me, well, very unhappy indeed. Myrtle placed a flower-covered hand on Thimble's shoulder.
Maybe, dearie, you can still do all those things as well as be in the royal household.
Myrtle was always looking on the bright side of things, but she knew as well as Thimble did that no royal was allowed to practice magic, and all royal ladies in the royal household had to wear a dress at all times. Thimble wished that Myrtle was right, but wasn't at all convinced by her kind words of comfort, for she knew only too well from her intense studies of fairy lore. Now, the ancient laws of fairy royal protocol had first been brought about in the first fairy reign, a time when the valley was still very heavily guarded as it had not been long claimed by its fairy occupants. All visitors were welcomed in their very best finery, and certainly no use of magic by any royal was allowed, in case any traveller travelling through felt threatened by it. As in those days, magic was looked upon somewhat differently as it is today. Now, these old traditions seemed very outmoded and old-fashioned, Thimble.
Yes, I know.
And no one really knew why the law had not been changed in so many millennium moons. However, a law was a law, and law number 352 read, all members of the royal household must be seen in their finest finery at all times, ladies in dresses and men in velvet breeches. And law number 398 read, "No fairy royal was to indulge themselves in the powers of their magic, as all visitors, fairy and non-fairy, must be made to feel an equal to the valley's crown and sovereign." Dear, dear, dear. Well, all this made absolutely no sense to Thimble at all, as to not be able to use her magic on the grounds of an outdated law made no sense to her at all. So, magic was now an accepted way of life, and the fairy folk of the valley were known for their peaceful lives. Besides, practicing magic was fun. And Thimble quite simply couldn't imagine her life without it. Myrtle placed a tea cake in front of Thimble in the hope it might cheer her up a little. Just as the door flung open, and who should hop in but the cause of all of Thimble's woes, Till himself, his blue velvet coat swishing behind him as he bounced past them and stuck a finger in one of the freshly baked cake sponges. "Ouch! That's hot," he huffed. Myrtle slapped his hand. "And not for you," she said, promptly taking the cake and putting it out of reach. Till had been out riding with the Queen's trainee knaves and got bored of playing chaperone and so hopped off to the kitchens for a second breakfast. He had not, however, anticipated coming across Thimble on his travels and was more than delighted when he saw her. "Why, Thimble, what an unexpected pleasure to see you, my beautiful fairy dearie." Thimble spat on the floor. Goodness, very unfairy-like. Not at all you'd expect. "I am not your fairy dearie. And if I have my way," Myrtle quickly interrupted. "What Thimble means is, Till dearie, is that we're trying to work on the finishing touches of your wedding cake. Now, you wouldn't want to spoil any surprise, would you now, dearie?" Till smiled a goofy smile. "Well, I had best leave you on your own then, hadn't I?" Thimble screwed up her face and just about managed not to stamp on his foot. "Yes, you had best leave us then," she said. And Till slowly tiptoed out of the kitchen, not taking his gaze from Thimble before finally shutting the door behind him. When Thimble was sure he was not standing outside the door listening, she let out an almighty cry. "For all the flour and sugar in this kitchen, he is the most repugnant, revolting, vulgar knave I have ever met. Promise you, Myrtle, if this cake works, I will be forever in your debt." And with that, she levitated off to the royal gardens to find Prunus, so he could help her with the wording for her speech for when she finally did get to confront Queen Lilibell. Queen Lilibell the Red had been ruler of the Fair Valley for hundreds of moons and as many sunrises. She had taken over the throne after the reign of her mother, Queen Rosebud the Red, who had stepped down to make way for her daughter's future. Rosebud had been a kind and thoughtful queen, and it had been written in the ancient manuscripts that she had seen the fairy kingdom through many hardships, including the war of misunderstandings between the flatland trolls and the fairies of this fair valley. Goodness. Which almost saw the kingdom invaded. It was said that a young fairy of the royal court called Lady Blossomberry, the only child and daughter to Rosebud's sister, who had always excelled in her studies of fairy magic, had taken to levitating to other realms to practice her skills. She had entered the Flatlands whilst out on one of her expeditions. Now, not only was it forbidden for a lady of the royal court to leave her realm without the elder's prior permission, but let us also not forget law number 398, which clearly states that no royal of the royal household is allowed to use magic. Unfortunately for this little fairy, her strange mutterings of magic and sudden vanishings had caught the attention of trolls. had used the flatlands for their dwellings for hundreds of moons. Their leader, Doran, known for his mistrust of every living soul, had thought the fairies had sent Blossomberry as a spy to claim the flatlands as their own, goodness. And with great fear of magic, had declared war on the fairy clan on the grounds of trickery. Dear, dear, dear.
I know.
After many moons of heated discussion, Queen Rosebud had finally gained their trust through patience and long counsels. She promised Doran and his trolls he could live in the flatlands for the rest of their days, without any fear of fairy magic ever changing that, and tranquility was finally restored. As for Lady Blossomberry, well, she was banished. Goodness me! She was banished from her fairy clan forever, as a fairy law had been disobeyed, and an example was made for both fairies and trolls alike to see. Goodness me! Now, although Lilibell the Red had her mother's leadership skills, she was also more impatient and demanding, and could be swayed by beauty more than truth and bribery more than trust. For this reason alone, she's a very different ruler indeed. She believed the sovereign's word was final and must be followed, which means Thimble was soon to tread on very treacherous ground. Now, I suppose the cake that Myrtle is preparing as we speak may very well go towards putting Thimble in the Queen's good books. But Thimble is treading on very rocky ground. I do hope the Queen's sweet tooth saves the day for our little fairy. Oh! The calling birds, you do like to interrupt me. Oh dear, I shall have to go. But next time, I shall tell you about Lady Blossomberry in a bit more detail. So I'm sure you'll want to come back and find out. Until then, take care. And remember, don't stop believing, especially in you.